unfassbar. Here on the screen, thank you so much. Good to see you. Good evening, Dr. Abbas.
Thank you for you.
Just a short introduction.
For everybody.
Super. Thank you so much. So Dr. Abbas is the head of the gastroenterology division at Bahman Hospital and attending consultant in gastroenterology, hepatology, and interventional proctology in Lebanon, with previous activities in clinical research at Saint-Antoine Hospital, and also a lecturer in gastroenterology at the Faculty of Medicine at LAU and LU universities. His research interests include hematology and oncology. And with that, I would like to pass over to you directly. Thank you so much for being with us today. Do you want to share your presentation?
Yes. Okay. Hello. You hear me?
Yes, we hear you perfectly. Thank you so much.
Okay, I can start.
The show is yours.
Okay. Good evening, everybody. Thank you for this nice presentation to be speaker with you tonight. I would like to thank Fabian and all of your team for this nice presentation. I will try to make a general overview of functional dyspepsia based on recent data from the literature. I will start with some questions to focalize my topic. The first question: functional dyspepsia does not require endoscopy to definitive workup, can be distinguished from gastroparesis based on symptoms, is a gastric disorder, only occurs in the Western world, and finally features element of visceral hypersensitivity and dependent of psychological comorbidity.
So Valentina, do you want to bring on the question? I'm a bit confused now. We want to avoid technical problems here. Dr. Abbas, do you think it'd be better to do this afterwards?
It's okay. The next question, the most effective treatment in functional dyspepsia is hypotherapy, small and regular meal, prokinetics, H. pylori eradications, or PPIs. The third question, a first-line treatment in epigastric pain syndrome is prokinetic, small and regular meal, PPI, amitriptyline, duloxetine. The fourth question, which neuromodulator is an evidence-based treatment for functional dyspepsia with refractory pain? Venlafaxine, amitriptyline, escitalopram, gabapentin, duloxetine. Okay. You hear me?
Doc. Yes, we hear you, but your internet is very
okay. Okay, I can continue.
Yes.
Okay. Agenda, the plan of my presentation is to start with some epidemiological data and then to define functional dyspepsia according to international classifications, then the etiological and pathophysiological mechanism, which are considered as the key for the therapeutic management. I will start with the epidemiology. As you can see here, dyspeptic symptoms are common in the general population with frequencies ranging from 10 to 45%, but varied among countries and according to the criteria used to define its presence. The annual incidence range from 1 to 6%. Long-term follow-up studies have suggested that symptoms improve or resolve more than half of patients, and about 50% of those symptoms seek medical attention, and 50% of those have functional gastrointestinal disorders. The frequency of investigated dyspepsia in the general population range from 7 to 37%. The overall pooled prevalence and investigated dyspepsia was 21%. The prevalence is significantly higher in women, smokers, NSAID users, and H. pylori positive individuals. No change in life expectancy, but quality of life is significantly affected by dyspepsia. Also, the cost burden, more than $18 billion per year. Factors that influence healthcare seeking are symptom severity, fear of underlying serious disease, psychological distress, and lack of adequate psychosocial support. In the majority of subjects with dyspeptic symptoms, no organic abnormality is found in 60% with normal gastroscopy. Identified by a routine clinical evaluation, including gastroscopy, and these patients are said to have functional dyspepsia. Diagnostic gastroscopy allows direct detection of organic causes of dyspepsia, such as peptic ulcer, erosive esophagitis, or malignancy. What is the prevalence of clinically significant endoscopic findings in subjects with dyspepsia? You can see here the broad definition of dyspeptic syndrome. Erosive esophagitis was the most common abnormality encountered, pooled prevalence 13.4%, followed by peptic ulcer disease, 8%. When we apply Rome 3 criteria, the prevalence of erosive esophagitis was lower when the Rome criteria were used to define dyspepsia compared with a broad definition. Only peptic ulcer disease was more common in individuals with dyspepsia. Further differential diagnosis, like H. pylori, Helicobacter pylori infection, medications, gastroparesis, biliary disease, pancreatic disease, etc. What about the definition and symptoms? As you know, several consensus definitions for dyspepsia and functional dyspepsia have been proposed, with the Rome consensus committees providing the most influential specifications. With time, definitions of dyspepsia have evolved to become more restrictive and focused on symptoms that are thought to arise from the gastroduodenal region, not the esophagus. What about the diagnostic criteria for functional dyspepsia? According to the Rome 4 consensus committee, only four symptoms: prandial fullness, early satiation, epigastric pain, and epigastric burning are now considered to be specifically of gastroduodenal origin. Also, many other symptoms are acknowledged as possibly coexistent. At least one of these symptoms for at least 3 months, with symptom onset at least 6 months before diagnosis, and no evidence of structural disease, including upper endoscopy, to explain the symptoms. This is a schematic representation of the classification subtypes of functional dyspepsia according to the ROM4 criteria. We have epigastric pain syndrome, EPS, and postprandial distress syndrome, PDS. One or both of the following symptoms at least one day a week lasts 3 months. Bothersome epigastric pain, bothersome epigastric burning. Bothersome, that means severe enough to affect daily activities. Bothersome epigastric pain at middle of the abdomen, with bothersome epigastric burning, with or without meal association. The other hand, for the PDS, the bothersome postprandial fullness after normal size meal, and bothersome early satiation, severe enough to not finish a normal size meal with or without reflux pain or nausea. There are also supporting symptoms for epigastric pain syndrome, like postprandial epigastric bloating, postprandial epigastric belching, nausea, and vomiting. And for PDS, postprandial distress syndrome, like postprandial pain or burning, epigastric bloating, excessive belching, nausea, or vomiting. What about the overlap symptoms? The issue of overlap between dyspepsia, GERD, and IBS has been a challenging one. How to differentiate functional dyspepsia, GERD, and IBS? Discrimination by symptoms, limited by overlap. The Room 3 and 4 consensus committees state that heartburn is not a gastroduodenal symptom. Also, it often occurs in association with symptoms of functional dyspepsia, green, and its presence does not exclude diagnostic functional dyspepsia. The frequent occurrence of functional dyspepsia and IBS is explicitly recognized in ROM 3 and 4 consensus guidelines and does not exclude diagnosis of functional dyspepsia. As you can see here, the prevalence of pathological reflux according to symptoms in patients with functional dyspepsia based on the Room 3 criteria. Early satiety, 35%, epigastric fullness, 38%, epigastric burning, 48%, and epigastric pain in 18%. There is an overlap also between gastroparesis and functional dyspepsia. The most common symptoms are early satiety, postprandial fullness. We can see nausea with diabetic gastroparesis, vomiting with diabetic gastroparesis, and epigastric pain, idiopathic gastroparesis. Additional symptoms are belching and bloating, which may go a little bit with functional dyspepsia. Specific symptoms suggestive gastroparesis like weight loss, poor glycemic control in diabetic patients, dehydration, and malnutrition. The prevalence of dyspepsia subgroups. The previous studies have shown considerable overlap PPS-PDS. 21% population-based study, up to 50 to 70% in secondary tertiary referral centers. The subtype distribution was 61% PDS bronchial distress syndrome, 18% epigastric pain syndrome, and 21% overlapping variant with both syndrome. According to this multicenter study with 8 secondary care centers from Belgium, 137 patients fulfilling from 3 criteria. We have 62% overlap EDS, EPS. In changing criteria room from room 3 to room 4, we have decreasing this number to 25%. So with room 4 criteria, we have less overlap EDS, EPS. What about the etiology and pathophysiology? As you know, multifactorial etiology and pathophysiology functional dyspepsia. For etiology, there is 4 things. And we talk about infectious etiology, possible genetic predisposition, psychological post and comorbidity, and the role of microbiome. I will start with the post-infectious etiology. Post-infection functional dyspepsia was first proposed as a clinical entity on the basis of a large retrospective study from a tertiary referral center. As you can see here, infectious gastroenteritis is associated with an increased risk for subsequent dyspepsia, 10% with this large meta-analysis with 19 studies and more than 9,000 cases of acute gastroenteritis. The other study, there were high prevalence and relative risk of functional dyspepsia, 26% versus 7% in the group control, following acute giardiasis and a higher degree of overlap between the disorders. So we can conclude that gastrointestinal infections is an important etiologic factor in functional dyspepsia. What about the genetic role? Population studies have suggested that genetic factors contribute to functional dyspepsia. This study with 237 consecutive functional dyspeptic patients, 7% with EPS, 23% PDS, 66% overlap with 250 health controls in India. The polymorphism of a gene protein, beta tripeptide 3 gene, have been associated with risk of functional dyspepsia. The TT genotype of this gene is more common among patients with functional dyspepsia, suggesting that increased signal transduction associated with this genotype may be important in its pathophysiology. However, the CCKR polymorphism is a protective against functional dyspepsia. There is no differences found, by the way, subtype functional dyspepsia. For the psychological comorbidity as etiology for functional dyspepsia, a review of the literature reveals clear association between psychological factors and functional dyspepsia. The most common psychiatric comorbidities in patients with functional dyspepsia are anxiety and depressive or somatoform disorders. What about the role of microbiome in functional dyspepsia in this study? Post-infectious functional dyspepsia assessment of duodenal microbiome by enclosed forceps in 9 functional dyspepsia qualifying from 3 criteria patients and 9 matched healthy volunteers. As you can see here, inverse relationship of streptococci to anaerobic vonella and velonella and actinomyces. Inverse correlation of total bacterial load with quality of life. And finally, positive correlation between duodenal bacterial load and symptom severity in response to test meal. Now, we will discuss the pathophysiological approach in functional dyspepsia. There is number of things involved: CNS modulation, gastroesophageal reflux, visceral hypersensitivity, gastric inflammation, duodenal mucosal alterations, intestinal dysmotility, overdistended antrum, delayed emptying, abnormal distribution of gastric contents, and decreased bundic accommodation. The pathophysiology is complex between the different pathway at the basis of the functional dyspepsia. Now, we analyzed data from this study to determine the population of individuals with diagnosis of functional dyspepsia before diagnosis of mood or anxiety disorders, gut to brain, and vice versa, brain to gut. The time period between diagnosis of mood or anxiety disorder and functional dyspepsia was longer, 4 years, than time period between diagnosis of functional dyspepsia and a mood or anxiety disorder, 1.5 years. We found 2-fold more patients receive a diagnosis of a mood or anxiety disorder before and functional dyspepsia. We can conclude that gut problems appear to impact more quickly mental health than vice versa, and socioeconomic factors play a role in development of functional dyspepsia patients with mood disorders. What about the visceral hypersensitivity? This is also an interesting multicenter study published in 2018, 5 cohorts in Europe and USA, with total number of 1,144 patients, 242 patients with functional dyspepsia, 6 female predominance, qualifying room 2 and room 3 criteria. The study showed gradual increase in GI sensitivity. Symptom increase and dependent of reporting tendency and comorbidities, anxiety and depression. So visceral hypersensitivity, independent contributor to GI symptom in functional dyspepsia. The duodenal mucosal alterations. Patients with functional dyspepsia, this study with 15 patients on three criteria, five age and gender matched healthy volunteers. These patients displayed lower transepithelial electrical resistance and increased paracellular passage compared with healthy controls, which is indicative of impaired mucosal integrity. Markers of impaired mucosal integrity and functional dyspepsia indicates underlying structural change. Also, the study showed the immune cells with an increased number of eosinophils, mast cells, and intraepithelial lymphocytes. Patients were characterized by the presence of low-grade inflammation, as demonstrated by increased infiltrations of mucosal mast cells and eosinophils. So we suggest that impaired intestinal barrier function is a pathophysiological mechanism of functional dyspepsia. Increased weight intake, driver of pathophysiology and symptoms in functional dyspepsia. According to this single center study from China with 101 functional dyspepsia patient newly diagnosed with functional dyspepsia and 31 asymptomatic controls, specific functional dyspepsia symptoms and gluten consumption patterns were evaluated by self-reported question. Tight junction protein, Claudin 1 expression, and the presence of intraepithelial lymphocyte infiltration in the bulb and the second portion of duodenum were assessed by immunohistochemistry. Among patients with functional dyspepsia, gluten-rich food may lead to symptom onset, specifically early satiety. Intestinal epithelial barrier dysfunction, characterized by decreased protein 1 expression and mucosal immune activation, demonstrated by intraepithelial lymphocyte infiltration, may contribute to the pathogenesis of functional dyspepsia. A proposed mechanism symptoms, delayed gastric emptying, responsible for the symptoms, postprandial fullness, nausea, vomiting, hypersensitivity, epigastric pain, belching, impaired accommodation, early satiety, weight loss, Helicobacter infection, noun, duodenal lipid hypersensitivity, nausea, esophageal acid sensitivity, heartburn, and longitudinal esophageal contractions, chest pain. Visceral hypersensitivity can be happen in both functional dyspepsia and gastroparesis. Visceral hypersensitivity, gastric and duodenal inflammation, enteral dysmotility, and decreased funding, accommodation. This is overlap pathophysiology between gastroparesis and functional dyspepsia. Visceral hypersensitivity in visceral dyspepsia, in functional dyspepsia, is an independent factor in symptom generation. What about the management of functional dyspepsia? The approach of an investigated dyspepsia, the initial aim of managing patients is to decide which patients can be managed empirically and which patients should be referred for additional diagnostic evaluation. a complete history and physical examination, some laboratory testing. Available options for the management include diagnostic endoscopy, followed by targeted medical therapy, non-invasive testing for H. pylori, followed by treatment based on the result, test and treat strategy, and empirical anti-secretory therapy. Additional investigations may be needed in patients with progressive or refractory symptoms that do not respond to initial management approach. For many patients, but not all patients, pharmacotherapy will be considered with different classes. PIs, eradication of H. pylori, prokinetics, agents that enhance gastric accommodation, centrally acting neuromodulators, other pharmacotherapeutic approaches. Also, patients with functional dyspepsia have a higher prevalence of psychosocial comorbidities. The role of psychosocial factors in generation of symptoms remains unclear. In part, because of these comorbidities, psychological interventions such as group support with relaxation training, CBT, psychotherapy, and hypnotherapy have been used in patients with functional dyspepsia. Summarized, according to the American consensus, 4 years ago, the ECG and CAG published a guideline how to manage a functional dyspepsia. As I told you, a patient with functional dyspepsia with mild or intermittent symptoms, reassurance, education, some dietary changes may be sufficient. Drug therapy can be considered in patients with more severe symptoms or those who do not respond to reassurance and lifestyle changes. The first step they proposed is testing for H. pylori. Infection is recommended. And positive, eradication therapy can be prescribed. Immediate impact on symptoms is unlikely, and any potential benefit is observed mainly over a longer period of follow-up. The next step is the use of PPI, and if available, acyclic antidepressant, prokinetics agents may also be used in initial pharmacotherapy. Symptom pattern may help determine the most appropriate initial choice of treatment, and a change in drug class is advisable in case the therapeutic response is insufficient. About the European consensus, this is in contrast with the recently published European guidelines, UEG and ESNM. As you can see here, so if we summarize step by step, dyspepsia is present. If we have chronic early satiation, postprandial fullness, epigastric pain, and epigastric burning, you need to endoscopy in 80% and test for H. pylori in 81%. Any of this is negative, you have functional dyspepsia. You don't need ultrasound, anting test, H monitoring to make the diagnosis. Risk factors are female sex, acute gastroenteritis, and anxiety, and eradication of Helicobacter pylori present are mandatory. for further workup, you subdivided two subgroups, PDS and PPS. But the first medical therapy beyond H. pylori eradication, 73% can use diet, 83% you can start. PPI. For further follow work up after the PPI, you can use tricyclic antidepressant in EPS and prokinetics for PDS. The next step, use of mirtazepine or bisoprenone for early satiety or weight loss. Finally, complementary or psychological therapy like hypnotherapy, CBT, then we can consensus for nutritional support. This is an overall recommendation and not shown here, but you don't need to do an endoscopy in everybody in primary care. When there is no alarm features, you can skip endoscopy. So consensus, an endoscopy, eradication of H. pylori, borderline tricyclic antidepressant in EPS, and nutritional support in the refractory case. Thank you very much for your attention.
Super, Dr. Abbas, so good to hear you. Thank you so much for this lecture. It was great. I would suggest that we now take a short break for you also to maybe have a sip of water, and then we continue together with you and Professor Berdran together to take questions that have been appearing here in the chat while you were having the lecture. You can now ask our two speakers to come and join me here on our virtual stage. Professor Berdran and Dr. Abbas, please join me here. Sure, Valentina can support that.
You cannot start because of the walls. That might be there.
There we go.
Okay.
Thank you so much. Oops. And we're still waiting for Dr. Abbas. Okay, but I guess we can start. There have been quite some, there we go, perfect. I think now we're complete. Okay. Good to have you back. There are a couple of questions that have come up, and I would like to delve straight into that. Maybe Professor Berdran, if you could elaborate a little bit more about the significance of Ramadan and the association with IBS. There have been quite a few questions of how can fasting and Ramadan obviously being one of the examples here affect IBS patients. What do they have to be aware of? And also, yeah, let's leave it with that for the moment. Maybe if you want to address that question.
So first of all, I want to thank the audience to be patient with me with all the problems that we have. So thank you everybody for being patient. So to address Ramadan, as I told you, there is no clear studies, prospective studies to evaluate this, this holy and fasting in IBS patient. There is some, let's say, small studies and not targeting IBS per se about a certain type of diet, let's say a normal diet with high fibers would be good for the constipation patient, and with patient with high fat could be better for patient with diarrhea type of IBS. But there's no clear answer for Ramadan association or effect on IBS patient. So probably it will be good to start this kind of study, especially as I told you, in Ramadan we have two parts. We have the faith part with it's a holy fasting, so the patient should be prepared for this, and he should have a certain kind of being relaxed, and this is a spiritual fasting with all the spiritual and the religious ritual that we see in Ramadan. So probably it's good to assess this part and plus the fasting in Ramadan, but there's no clear studies in Ramadan in IBS, especially in IBS ROM4 type patient.
Maybe following up on that, though, are there any particular recommendations that you would like to put out there on how to behave during Ramadan, maybe when it comes to nutrition or any other fields that may help people with IBS?
So the problem here, because the absence of, let's say, any studies, a prospective study, so we cannot give certain recommendation. Here we go back to how to treat patient with IBS.
Okay.
In general, let's say, taking care, for example, if the patient has constipation, so he has to increase fibers, not too much, try to help himself with certain kind of medication that will help him in treating his symptoms, especially with the change. And one additional thing, there's the change in the eating habits that could affect the patient. But do we have to stick to the guidelines? I think in the absence of special or prospective studies, we cannot stick to guidelines. We can, let's say, try starting by the medication, which could affect the symptom, which is most important, the bothersome symptoms in the patient. Let's say if he has bloated, try to modify his diet, add something to relieve his bloating, some charcoal, let's say. If he's constipated, probably some association charcoal with senna, or treat the increased fibers. And especially in region when we have these combination drug, we have the luxury to have this combination drug. Sometimes we are off guidelines, and try to use these medication as combination. Let's say patient with pain and bloating, you can give him something to antispasmodic with something to relieve the bloating. In constipation, you can add senna with something charcoal. Let's say like example in eucarbon, we can treat bloating. So basically, you go for the symptoms.
Okay.
In IBS.
Dr. Abbas, maybe also around fasting here, what are the factors that may increase dyspepsia during fasting time?
As you know, that eating meal is a key factor in the occurrence of symptoms during functional dyspepsia. The factors that are significantly associated with functional dyspepsia are eating behaviors, regular meal patterns, and moderate to fast eating rates. Concerning dyspepsia in Ramadan, no strong studies available until now, but in one study published by the Iranian team in 2017, showed that dyspepsia, dyspeptic patients can fast during the Ramadan, but they are advised not to consume large volume meals in iftar and the suhoor.
Okay. Thank you so much. Maybe going back to a very particular question here, Professor Bedrana, moving away from fasting, which is just around the corner, but there's also some other questions here. Professor Bedran, do you think that in IBS-D, so diarrhea, of course, do you think that lab tests such as IgA, anti-transglutaminase, and calprotectin levels in stools should be performed in order to rule out associated or other diseases such as celiac disease or Crohn's disease?
The answer is yes, in a region where it's very common to have, let's say, we have an increased number of patients with, let's say, celiac or IBD, let's say in North Europe. So definitely it's one of the first diagnostic tool to rule out any IBD or celiac. But in region, well, it's not that frequent. We can always ask for these tests. But is it a must? Some recommendation, because it's coming from Europe, where it's more frequent, this disease, recommend for the use of calprotectin and anti-transglutaminase. But we here we should open a bracket, because anti-transglutaminase, if it's negative, it's not an exclusion exclusion diagnosis test. So basically, using it, it's not against recommendation. But is it that frequent in Lebanon in the absence of any other symptom? Let's say if we have extraintestinal manifestation of IBD, let's say joint pain or back pain, with the suspicion of ankylosing spondylitis, definitely you have to go for calprotectin. But in the absence of these symptoms, and simply you have all the criteria for IBS, in our region, I think my answer, this is something I don't do frequently, unless the patient is coming frequently to see me and he has been through all the medication and is not that good. And I go back with no alarming feature. It's very important.
Okay, thank you so much. Dr. Abbas, question to you here. Is there any correlation between the gut microbiota and dyspepsia? Any studies that you can refer to?
Of course, the gut microbiota is a very important role in our health by helping control digestion and unifying our immune system, as many other aspects of health. Any imbalance of unhealthy and healthy microbes may contribute to such disorders. In terms of dyspepsia, the studies are highly suggestive for a possible role of microbiome in the pathophysiology of this disorder, but much studies are needed.
Okay, so we're still at the beginning there of finding the way forward. One question here that often concerns us also and often comes up is the question of how do you decide whether you have failed with IBS management? When do you say, okay, we cannot go any further? This is where we stand, Professor Bedran.
So the problem with IBS is the severity of symptoms. If it's a mild disease, we have no problem. We always manage to treat this patient. When we go for refractory patient, and this is the difficulty, here I think will be the perfect role of the multidisciplinary team. And refractory or failure, there's no failure in IBS, because failure, it means we have to take more severe action, let's say action, a surgery or something like this. It has no place in IBS, and especially it can be harmful in patient with IBS. So basically there's no thing that we call failure. There are refractory patients, and at that time, these refractory patients are the probably should be more treated by psychiatrists, and sometimes they are difficult to treat, and they have to combine medication for I'm talking about psychiatric medication or non-drug, let's say, non-pharmacological. So these patients are refractory. This is what I prefer that we say, not failure, refractory patient. Yes, these patients exist. And it's we have a lot of studies on these patients because it could represent 10% of our patients easily.
Okay. Thank you. Dr. Abbas, I'm sure this question, I mean, actually also came into you, Dr. Bedran, is always probiotics. Where do you stand on probiotics in your respective fields? I mean, maybe towards IBS, Dr. Bedran, if you would like to start, and then dyspepsia, what is your view?
If we're going to go according to guideline, AGA guidelines, usually recommend against the use of probiotics because there's no sufficient data for it. But if in the same review, if we go for the introduction, we see that 1/4 of our patients, especially in constipation, IBS-C, they don't use the treatment, the FDA approved treatment, excuse me, the 1/4 use the FDA treatment because they are expensive. So at that time, we have to ask ourselves the same question that we see all and over, because do we follow recommendation? Do we follow guidelines? The guidelines is there. Yes, we have to follow guidelines, but there's a lot of guidelines that start by something which is has no side effect, such as probiotic and herbal, despite the fact that we don't have sufficient data or data against to use it, we can always use it. We can see after, let's say 10 weeks, if there is no success, we can shift because we are dealing with a disease with no, quote unquote, no complication, no organic complication. And if the only problem that we can encounter when we delay a little bit our treatment is to have this burden, this mental disorder burden, that will it could be a slightly increased with no, let's say, dangerous increase. So basically, we can always have time to use exercise, to use good sleep, to go for probiotics, to go for antispasmodic. And even if you see the recommendation for antispasmodic is a little bit confusing. So basically, beside the FDA approved, we don't have a solid data, but all the guidelines will say, go for something with no side effect, try it, especially in mild disease or an early moderate disease, morally moderate IBS. And if no success, you always have time to change, to go for something, to try another treatment.
Okay, thank you so much.
So I use it sometimes, probably.
When nobody's watching. Dr. Abbas, would you like to comment on probiotics and the relationship to dyspepsia? I mean, the topic of your lecture.
According to my presentation, there is a possible role for herbal remedies that may be of some benefit for functional dyspepsia, include a combination of peppermint and carawia oils, which relieve pain symptoms. Another herbal agent like STW5, as mentioned in my presentation, this therapy containing extract of 9 herbs may improve intestinal motility and relieve GI spasm. Also, leucarbon is a natural intestinal regulator and may alleviate various symptoms of functional dyspepsia, but no strong studies are available until now.
Thank you so much. What are, for you, when it comes to functional dyspepsia, what are the most alarming signs associated with functional dyspepsia? The question came in.
The alarming signs are the presence of blood hematemesis or hematochezia, presence of anemia or weight loss, the presence of family history of malignancy in the GI and the gastroesophageal regions. Also the age, more than 55, considered as alarm features.
Okay. Thank you so much. Now we are running out of time here. It's 8:30, which is what we suggested as an end for this conversation. Maybe we can take one or two more questions, but I don't want to stretch your patience here. Okay, so did I understand? I mean, here the question came in: can I have a celiac patient and IBS at the same time? And if there are no symptoms of celiac, are they only related to gluten allergy? How do you see that, Dr. Abbas?
Excuse me, can you repeat the question?
So can I have a patient that has celiac disease and IBS at the same time? I think is what the question is aiming for.
Of course, celiac disease is one of the differential diagnoses that we must rule out during investigations by taking duodenal biopsy or by doing a serological test like anti-transglutaminase or anti-endomysium antibodies.
Okay. Professor Bedran, also going through some of these questions, you have mentioned allocitron in the treatment of IBS with diarrhea. The person asking here is asking whether that is really a good way forward, because to his knowledge, it has been withdrawn in several markets. How do you see that?
First of all, I want to comment on IBS with celiac. Even in latent celiac or a patient with HLA DQ2 to Q8 with no symptoms regarding to celiac, if you go for a gluten-free diet, you will have some benefit on IBS. And even in celiac disease, definitely when you have celiac disease, or you have all the immune system that is activated. So definitely with IBS patient, they will benefit if you have symptoms. And I'll go for allocetron. I think he's mentioning allocetron, which was removed until 2000 from the market in the USA, but it was reintroduced with certain restriction for female patient above 18 years old, because we can have some kind of we had some colitis, ischemic colitis with the use of this product. But it's very, very efficient drug, but it's still in use. There's a lot of meta-analysis recently done that showed that it's very good. Now we are going to other type of 5-HT agonists like ondansetron that we are using now for treatment of vomiting post chemotherapy. So it shows some good results in IBS, and probably it has a place. So till now, allocetron, it's used. We'll try to, if ondansetron will be good, so probably it will be replaced by it. But till now, it's used since 2002.
Okay, thank you. Yeah. Another question here: what is your view on lactose, and to what extent it can even lead to the diseases? I mean, cause is the actual question. The diseases that you're both talking about, IBS and dyspepsia.
So, as far as IBS, definitely lactose, because we. Majority we are lactose intolerant, so basically we are using something that we can overproduce gas and we can induce diarrhea. So basically it's lactose, it's very unhealthy, let's say, for a patient with IBS. But to cause the disease, no, it causes the flare of symptoms more than the cause of the disease. because lactose is not absorbed. So theoretically, even if we increase the permeability or any kind of peripheral cause for IBS, so theoretically it shouldn't cause any harm either on the mucosa or beyond it. So it's something that could increase the production of gas, and it could be a cause for bloating or diarrhea in patients with IBS, like in other patients when we are intolerant for when we are lactose intolerant.
Okay, thank you. How would you comment on lactose in your case, Dr. Abbas?
The same for Dr. Badran. There is a strong correlation between lactose intolerance and the dyspeptic syndrome, especially with the postprandial fullness.
Okay, thank you so much for that add-on. Actually, coming back to what was the first question initially, is whether IBS and dyspepsia is probably similar, how they can affect vitamin or iron deficiencies. For example, in the case of malabsorption, how would you comment on that?
You want to comment, Abbas?
No, please, Professor Badran, yeah.
Okay. So in IBS patient, we don't have a problem of malabsorption. So theoretically, we shouldn't have any iron deficiency. So if we have an iron deficiency, at that time, you have to search for a cause for it. So sometimes iron can induce certain kind of diarrhea when we take the iron. So it's a drug, it's a side effect of the drug. But the iron deficiency or any malabsorption, it's not related, it couldn't be related to IBS, because in IBS, theoretically, we should have a normal mucosa. If not, we should go for organic disease.
Dr. Abbas?
The same mentioned by Dr. Badran, we don't have in dyspepsia any structural disease, so no malabsorption. The only risk factor, the presence of H. pylori, that may decrease the absorption of iron in dyspepsia. But in this case, we cannot talk about functional dyspepsia. We can talk about H. pylori-associated dyspepsia.
Super. Thank you so much to both of you. Thank you so much for your time and your insightful lectures. I would like to close here and really thank you for your time. I enjoyed myself, and I hope all of you here in front of the screens did as well. I hope you did, Professor Badran and then Dr. Abbas. And I very much hope to see you again very soon, virtually or in person. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you very much.
And thank you for your patience, especially. And thank you for the invitation. I hope to see you here in Lebanon.